Dear Lord, I just pray that you be with this message today, Lord. I pray that you open our hearts, Lord, to receive what you need to let us know today. God, I just thank you for opportunities like this, Lord, that we can let those under come forward and to prepare messages, Lord, from you and of you, to speak in front of brothers and sisters, Lord, and congregation, Lord, to just grow in faith, Lord. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So I'll be reading from 1 Thessalonians 5, 12 through 28, if you want to turn there. I'll give you a brief summary real quick while you turn. To understand where I'm coming from, we need to know what 1 Thessalonians is about. It is the first of two letters written from Paul to the Thessalonian churches to give them encouragement and instructions to guide them further into Christ. I encourage you to go and read the rest of the book to get a better and personal understanding. But for now, I want to focus on the instructions Paul is giving the people of Thessalonica to help them grow closer to Christ and to one another. I want to emphasize on these three points: rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks through all circumstances, which I know can be hard. But through Christ, all things are made possible and people made new. So if you're there, I'll read from 5:12, and it reads, "Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those of the work who work hard among you and who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other, and we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks through all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who calls you his faithful, and he will do it. Brothers and sisters, pray for us. Greet all God's people with a holy kiss. I charge you before the Lord to have this letter read to all the brothers and sisters. Grace to our Lord Jesus Christ be with you." So I kind of just broke down the verses, and I want to go into detail with them. So in verse 12, we see that Paul is encouraging us to acknowledge those who work hard among us and who care for us and admonish us, and to hold them in the highest regard, he says. So make sure you thank your brothers and sisters who are working hard among you, caring for you and others, and who admonish you and others. In 13, he's instructing us to hold those in the highest regard in love because they sacrifice so much. The average person cannot do what they do. That does not make them better. That does not make them worse, but emphasizes the point that God gave each of us special gifts to further his kingdom and to grow each other. Each of you should use whatever gift you received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in this various form. That's from 1 Peter 4:10. If you turn to Romans 6:12, 6 through 8, I'll read from there next. Romans 12:6-8 reads, "We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is to give, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully." In 14, he urges us to warn those who are idle and disruptive, because we can't get to our destination if we never leave. It can be very easy to become idle in today's world. So we need to make sure that we are checking on one another and ourselves. Because we don't know if, sometimes it's hard to know if we're getting idle or being in a rut. It's easy to see someone being disruptive, and it can be a disruption and distracting that we can lose the sight of the message we need to hear. And it can be hard to know when we ourselves might become idle. So you might ask yourself, am I becoming idle? What does it look like when I am idle? And pray and look for opportunities to become serious with God and others around you. It also tells us to encourage the disheartened and help the weak, because we know that temptation never ceases. But instead disrupts and weakens us Christians. And that is just the spiritual part. The world tears us down each and every day as well. We have bills to pay, children to tend to, and a lot of negativity in this world that wears us down so much. It also tells us to be patient with everyone. That is a hard thing to do, be patient. But we must do it to our best ability, because without patience, our message can become harsh instead of loving. Our discipline can become damaging rather than correcting. So we need to be helping and encouraging those around us, going through tough times right now, and be in prayer over them, and be patient with everyone. Because it may take some time for God to do a work through them and their situation. Because we know it is not our timing, but God's. 15, it tells us to never pay back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other. Because we can shine the light of Christ, but we can't do that if we're casting shadows or doing evil. Plus, God tells us to forgive one another and never tells us to get revenge or hang around the situation, but always forgive and move on. Ephesians 4:32 says, to be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ forgave you. And Colossians 3:13 says, bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And there's so many more that back it up as well. Matthew says it in 6:14, again in 18:21 and 22, and in Luke 17:4, just to name a few. In verses 16 through 18, it says, rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks through all circumstances. For this is God's will in Christ Jesus. Rejoicing always we can say is really hard to do. When there's a loss in the family, a breakup, whether as a friend, as a boyfriend, girlfriend, as marriages, it's hard. Financial struggle also gets us down too. Hardship comes through everything that happens on earth, full and affects everyone differently. But thankfully, through Christ, we have a joy through his salvation. In Psalms 51:12, it says, restore me to the joy of your salvation and grant me with your willing spirit to sustain me. No, it doesn't say to cure me or solve me, but instead says sustain, which is a thing that needs to be refilled or recharged. When you eat a meal, it sustains you for a period, till dinner time comes and you're hungry again. So when you need to get sustained, in the same way, when you need to be sustained by food, in the same way you need to be sustained in the Spirit. So in the same way, have a prayer, a repetitive prayer, so that you can be refilled and recharged daily. Now, praying continually is something everyone can struggle with because there's so many things to pray about, so many things to be thankful for, so many problems in the world. Yet we tend to save them all up for one or two prayers a day. I know I do. And we forget a lot of what happened and leave a lot out. But And it's like when your friend or sibling or spouse is only talking to you a couple times a day. It can hurt. You can feel left out or in the dark. And it makes it hard to start, maintain, or keep a relationship alive. We need to remember communication is key in every relationship. So when we pray more often and give thanks through the good, the bad, and ugly, we can build a better relationship with Him. And when I say pray continually, I want you to understand that it does not literally use every second of the day praying, because we know that it is almost impossible to do that. But one thing we can understand about prayer is that it is intentional time spent with God, talking, being quiet, listening. It's just intentional time. So with that in mind, we can have an attitude of prayer. And what I mean by that is we need to intentionally think of God and what He is doing for us on our day-to-day. We also have a thing called breath prayers. A lot of people do it. And it is as simple as breathe in, thank you, Jesus, and breathe out your praise. For example, thank you, Jesus, for today. Thank you, Jesus, for brothers and sisters. Thank you, Jesus. Now, giving thanks is not that hard to do. We do it quite often as Christians. But in all circumstances, that's what gets us. Sometimes we let circumstances get the better of us and end up feeling more hurt in the moment than helped. But we need to remember that God's plan is coming true through it all. And though it is hard, we can make it through. It was God's plan for you to get that lifelong friend from school, or marry a wonderful spouse, or get that job. But it is also in God's plan for those to fade away, because we are not here on this earth forever. We will one day be with Him. And though it hurts, we know we can get through it because of Christ. We know His plan is unraveling every day. Every day. In 19 and 22 through 22, we see here that we should never quench the Spirit, even through hard times and hardship. This too shall pass. As much as we shouldn't treat anything with contempt, we sometimes get bogged down with worldly views and let that dictate our thoughts and emotions. But when we do that, we need to catch ourselves and not get confused. We should go back to the verses 16 and 17 and rejoice always and pray continually through the hard times. And remember that we have a book that has proven again and again that every prophecy that is of Christ and for Christ has come true and will come true. Amen. So remember, Christ is above all. With that in mind, we are told to test all prophecies and hold on to what is good, and reject every kind of evil. In today's world, as we get closer to Christ coming, there is so much evil. To be extra cautious of what we are doing, we need to be careful of what we are watching, what we're listening to, and who we're around, because that can be the start of evil within us. There are false prophets among us, we all know, so just be careful. In 23 and 24, Paul is reminding us that we need to do the commands to have a blameless spirit, soul, and body, and that God of peace will sanctify us through and through, because the one who calls us is faithful, and He will do it. And though we are humans, we have our own flaws, and many of them. But through God, a forgiving God, we have heaven waiting for us. And we know that we have a Father who is no matter who we are His. And what we are going through is in His hands. And we are going to, for us to His hands, out for us to repent and follow Him. And He will forgive us. In 25 and 20 through 28, He ends the letter with this: pray for us. So pray for those among you who are guiding you in Christ, and that we need to pray for one another because we are all facing trials and tribulations. He says to greet all God's people with a holy kiss. And we know that a kiss is a sign of love and caring. So when you greet someone, do it with love and care, because we are all God's people. Paul charges us to share this letter with everyone. So try your best to share it with someone this week. I want to urge you to practice rejoicing always, praying continually, and giving thanks through all circumstances. And to look out for one another, for we all can be hurting in some way. Be patient with one another so that we come across loving, not harsh. And that no matter who you are or what you've done, Christ is waiting with open arms to lift you up. If you've fallen out or feel idle or lost, know that God has left the 99 already, and he's with you in this time of need. We also have wonderful elders, deacons, and pastors who are here for guidance and prayer over you in your situation. So turn to them if you need help. And if you'll bow with me, I'll pray at the end. Dear Lord, I thank you for this wonderful day. I thank you for everything that you're doing in each of our lives. God, I pray that you be with each of us in our day-to-day, Lord. I pray that you please guide us through this evil and lead us unto you. God, I pray that we are all stewards of you and servants of your love. God, I pray that we can reach out to someone this week to share in you, with them, with you. God, I pray that we all take home what we need to take home from this sermon. God, I pray that we just lean on you in every time. God, I pray if that we are idle, we are searching for you. I pray that we can see if we are idle and disruptive. God, I pray that we can push out all distractions of evil and turn to you to understand what you are telling us through the day to day. God, I pray that we know that through all circumstances, you remain. And that even though everything will fade away, we will be with you. God, I thank you for this time today. I thank you for everyone, and I pray for everyone. God, thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.